My talk will be about broadening Scala. So the idea is, Scala is a nice language, but you can still improve it in a quite simple way, I think. So overview is, I'll argue that notation matters. So I'm not going to talk deeply about high-level concepts of programming languages, but just notation. And I'll argue that it would be good to open up Scala more, the Scala compiler, to support better notations. And I'll discuss a little bit about talk a bit about DSLs, domain-specific languages, versus language extensions. And finally, I'll give some wild ideas what you can do. So let's have a look at the history of the print statement in C. It was quite nice, 1980. Then we got C++, and I didn't like it that much. It became bigger. And in Java, in around 1996, you see, progress in time is not always progress in concepts and so on. This was a real disaster. Then 2004, Java was a bit better, closer to C. We get Scala and Groovy, and we were back at C, even a little bit better, because we didn't have this trailing semicolon anymore. They don't need it. So, and I think that's a real improvement. And in 2012, Scala improved even further with these string interpolations. So we now also have type checking for formatted string formatting. And that's also an improvement. And I think what you can learn of this, we can make things better and shorter. And Scala is in the right direction, but we can do more than that. For instance, this is a typical GUI controller for a client program in Scala. Don't want you to read it, but you see a lot of indentation, a lot of braces and so on, and there is a lot of runnables and so on invoked, and it's quite a messy code. So I presented this theory as a go here for this subscript language. A subscript is, in the implementation, a Scala library or a subscript virtual machine, and you operate this library through a set of functions, so you can call that a DSL. And when you do that, you get these kinds of calls, and it's not really much better than you had in the previous slide. But there is a kind of nice structure underlying this. It's the theory of process algebra. But if you add some syntax, then you get something really nice. And what you see here in search sequence, these four search commands and so on, that's what you had here. So with a bit, with your own special syntax, you can improve a real lot. And this is a Scala extension, so you can mix your Scala code with these things. So these things are called scripts. They're a bit like methods. And from these scripts, you can go back to Scala with code between these braces here. So there is some interaction between two languages. Bit similar, Parboiled 2, it's a parser definition language. We use it also for subscript. And here's some code that parses traits and so on. And it is quite nice. It's much better than coding, I think, than writing just plain Scala. But this is a DSL, domain-specific language, and it has the limitations of Scala. And I thought about this. Could we do this better if Parboiled had his own syntax? And I think, yes, I think it would come down to this. And here you see also, just like a subscript, I use the space operator as a sequential composition. It's also much like you have in yet another compiler, YARC. It's basically technology of the 1970s. So I would argue that we can do better. And if you look at the Java virtual machine, it's much bigger than Java itself. The JVM became a platform for lots of languages. And likewise, I think Scala can be changed in a way that Scala could become a base language for lots of languages. Let's say also the Scala compiler. The Scala compiler would be the technological equivalent to the JVM, in a way. But what do you need to do then? Well, you can have plugins in the Scala compiler, but the part that you cannot change is the front end. It's the scanner and the compiler and the parser, and that's a pity. A few years ago, I asked the Scala team in Amsterdam on Scala Days whether they would be willing to open this up, and the compiler writer said, "No. Don't let's make all the allows of all these dialects. It's dangerous. It would be opening Pandora's box. You could get a Babylonic confusion." But then Miles Sabin said, "Well, maybe it's not so good, such a bad idea. Let's allow for all these new variations and so on." And so. Yeah, that's the other side. So if you allow for these variations, you allow for creativity from the community, and you there could be a kind of evolution and the survival of the fittest. And another nice property is you get lots more applicability of Scala, and in a way there is a certain standardization on Scala, which is diminishing the chaos in our field, I would say. But about DSLs, so these domain-specific languages, they're always traditionally presented as internal versus external. In internal DSL is just Scala code in the context of Scala, but with these user-defined operators and with some implicits and so on, and some macros. And you can do a whole lot with those, but you're always limited to Scala syntax. As you've seen with Parbold, we should do better than that, I think. The alternative, as normally presented, is external DSLs, which means you must write your own compiler and parser and preprocessor. And that is not just a lot of work, but you also lose the standard benefits that Scala gives you, because you don't write the entire new Scala compiler. So I think it's better in general to have language extensions, so enrich Scala with the extra syntax that you need for a specific area. And then you can also have mutual embedding, so call this extended language from Scala and the other way around. And then you need also specific language borders, so if with a subscript you have the word script. And you can also go to subscript using these rectangular brackets. And you can go back to Scala with these braces and just parentheses. So let's give a few what are these what you could do as well if you have a full control over syntax in scanner and parser. I don't like repetitions of things, even of small things. And here you see twice the word dev, and sometimes you have lots of devs. Why not write just something like this, dev, dot, 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 and then there's a bit less repetition here. I like that. And you could also do this for let's say, case clauses. So typically you would have an abstract or a trait for statements, for instance, and you have a lot of case clauses, and they all extend these. Why not write this down like this? Just add some dot dot dots and then fill it in here. That is one of these about these. Let's go to the next one. Text macros, bit similar. So you could have such code in a match statement, for instance, a partial function. But here you see all these words cases. Why not write like this? So first dot dot dot, which means we get a kind of simple text macro, and then we say case sequence, and then we have parameters and the result, and I have a table for the parameters and the result. Or do it like this, just write down the first statement, and then have between these backticks what you find. A bit like the parameters, but you don't name the parameters especially, but you just give the first value. And then you can repeat it over here and then fill in the other things. So this was the next wild idea that I had. And well, this, by the way, it would not be limited to Scala. You could do this in any language, and also even in data description languages like YAML, I think. Parameterless layout. So there is this Scala improvement process, and Martin Odersky proposed to have the if-then-else syntax, and you would get rid of these parentheses after the if. I think that's a good idea. Martin Odersky is also from the group of Niklaus Wirth in Zurich, and Wirth was the maker of Pascal, so Scala could go back to the Pascal syntax a bit. But it has been postponed, but I think that's a good idea. But why not get also rid of the braces over there, like in Python? And this is also supported by an extension that Li Haoyi has made. And by the way, Li Haoyi is also active in an alternative parser for Scala. He calls it Scala Parse. And it looks quite good, and that could also be good replacement for the standard parse in the Scala compiler. Another thing, I want to get rid of as many parentheses as possible, and also parentheses in the function calls. And if you look at Smalltalk, this object-oriented language created early in the 70s, you had this kind of syntax. You had a Boolean expression, and then you had a message if true, if false. And it was kind of if statement, but it was also a method. And we could also have similar syntax in Scala. In fact, in Subscript, we have an alternative, some syntax like that. So we could say a function do with message and then something with parentheses, or use a Smalltalk-like syntax. Bit different because we now have a comma to make sure that the compiler understands that we get another parameter instead that we set off a kind of white space operator. And you could also, let's say for the substring method in Scala, I never understand what the parameters mean. So I always have to look it up, but why not write something like substring from 3 to 8 or so, or from 3 to and length 5. Next thing, data flow. There is lots of data flow in our programs, but you don't see that often. We have always these function calls. What if you have a computation function which provides an integer, and you want to do something with the result, and the result could either be an integer or it could be an exception. Think of the talk that Phil Wadler gave this morning. You have an either with an exception and an int, a bit like this. What you want to... wait a minute. So this is what you normally do. You show, forget a bit about the exception. That's for the next slide. But normally what you do is you have a computation and you can say match and then print something. Or you have a different show method and you can call show over the computation. But an alternative syntax would be with arrows. It's just not a different notation. And it would come down to exactly the same as above. So you have these arrows or which come down to this match statement, or you create a partial function show using this arrow notation, and then you could have this syntax here, which also generates a match statement for you. So that's and this syntax is also working in Subscript right now, and you could enrich it with exceptions. You have a kind of either-like construct with left or right. I did here with an object fail, which makes a pair with the exception. So you do the computation. If there is an exception, you handle it. And then whatever the result is, neither an integer or this exception, you bring it to the match, and then you do something with it. And you could write it down as well with these arrows. Just like this. Or again, you can make a partial function for these instead of previous notation, and then use this partial function. Next idea, yeah, about operators. So right now the operators like plus and so on are binary, but a bit more general, a plus you could consider it as n-ary, so having more than two arguments. In some cases, like in subscript, you really need that. Another thing is new line and space and the semicolon. You could also interpret in Scala those as operators, I think. And that would open up also some possibilities. You can drop infix notation, like you have in 1 to 10. You have these spaces between 1 and 2 and 10. What you could do, for instance, also have a prefix notation. So if you have a plus over lots of terms in a parsing expression, you could have the plus just after the equal sign. Or even if you have multiple lines and you want to have the horizontal white space mean something different than the vertical new line operator, you can say that horizontally white space is sequence and vertically it's choice. So you have a number or a string or a sequence of parentheses, expression parentheses. This is the style that the Java language specification has been written in. Well, to drop these infix calls, this is typical Scala code currently, but if you want to have spaces available for sequences, you must drop these infix calls. And how could you do it in this case? Just allow symbols to start with dot dot, and then you would have these kinds of expressions. So to go up from 1 to 10 or to go down. These are alternative notations, so we don't really need these white space operators for function calls in Scala. So that I come to the conclusion. So I think some of you may be the language designers of the future, and I hope to inspire you to make coding better, to make it conciser and clearer. The alternative approach is on doing things. You can find on the site of a German guy. It's called languageengineering.io, and he mixes even graphs and so on with program text. Also very nice, I would say very nice work. So I argued that notation matters, and we can, in principle, Scala can be broken up, but it should be a real also in the Scala community. DSLs or extensions. So I think the old notion of DSLs have to go. And I gave some what it is. So that concludes my presentation. Do you have any questions? Thank you for your attention.
Thank you.
In principle, on that slide that you presented with the exception handling, the try exception handling, you could have used...
Yes?
Yeah. No, the one with try, yes, and catch. In principle, you could have used the try object to wrap up the exception. So you use not try compute, little try compute, but try from the capital T, try compute, and then match on successes or failures. So what is your view on that approach versus the one that you propose?
I don't really get it. So can you please slowly?
I mean there is an object called try in Scala that...
Oh, yeah, the try and
F. Yeah, so what is your view on using that instead of the approach with error?
So I thought that would be convenient, but for some reason I didn't use it. I think it maybe the matching went a bit wrong. Maybe I couldn't express the matching because you have to wrap up everything in the success, and this way you don't need to. Maybe that was it. Yeah. That's also the reason why I didn't use the either and left and right.
How do you think it compares with Lisp approach? Where
if you a bit louder.
How do you think it compares with Lisp approach, which is homo-iconic, and you don't have to introduce new parsing rules to have your own syntax? Do you think this approach is better, or Lisp can do?
In a way, it's a matter of taste, but I think Lisp lacks the proper variation of layout and symbols like arrows and pluses and so on. It's too much text, and there's also too many parentheses. Personally, I think we must get rid of these parentheses. A complexity of parentheses is as soon as you open one, you must search for where the closing companion is. So I think layout can do a lot of improvement over there. Yeah, but on the other hand, technically Lisp does a very big, great job in extensibility. I'm not sure whether hacking in the parse and so gets to that level, but I think we should aim for that, not knowing how far we can go.